Hello all. Today we will talk about a very important topic in neurophysiology, which is synaptic plasticity. So first let us come to the definition. What is synaptic plasticity? The strength of a neuronal synapse, which is actually the magnitude of postsynaptic response, can be increased or decreased due to history of previous discharge. And this modification of synaptic strength is called synaptic plasticity. Now, synaptic plasticity is the basis of memory in neuronal circuit, and also it is the basis of learning at the level of cerebellum. Evidence is strong that synapses are the physical site of many, if not most, forms of memory storage in the brain. And there are multiple mechanisms that exist for synaptic plasticity. But it is very difficult to specify which form of memory, like short-term memory or long-term memory, uses which particular form of synaptic plasticity. So here is the classification of synaptic plasticity. So on the basis of duration, it can be divided into short-term synaptic plasticity and long-term synaptic plasticity. Most of the short-term synaptic plasticities are usually presynaptic changes. On the other hand, most of the long-term synaptic plasticities are postsynaptic changes. So depending on whether the synaptic strength is increased or decreased, short-term changes in synaptic plasticity may be classified as facilitation, augmentation, and post-tetanic potentiation, where the synaptic strength is increased. On the other hand, in case of depression and habituation, synaptic strength is decreased. All these are examples of short-term changes in synaptic plasticity, where the changes usually occur at the presynaptic terminal. Long-term synaptic plasticity, which happens at the level of postsynaptic membrane, the examples are long-term potentiation or LTP and long-term depression or LTD. Now moving on to short-term changes. Short-term changes usually occur at the presynaptic terminal, as already discussed. So increased strength. All short-term changes that lead to increased synaptic strength are due to high-frequency stimulation. And the examples are facilitation, augmentation, and post-tetanic potentiation. Facilitation lasts 10 to hundreds of milliseconds. Augmentation lasts for several seconds. And post-tetanic potentiation, it lasts for tens of seconds to several minutes, and it outlasts the period of high-frequency stimulation. And the example of decreased strength of the synapse are depression and habituation. It may be due to high or low frequency stimulation. Depression can occur during high frequency stimulation, and habituation is a slowly progressing decrease in synaptic strength that occurs during relatively low frequency stimulation. So here we can see that due to rapid train of action potentials, facilitation, potentiation, and depression can happen. And here we can see that with slow train of action potential, habituation can happen. All these are examples of short-term changes in synaptic strength. Now, what are the mechanisms for short-term changes? The most important and significant mechanism for short-term synaptic strength change is the presynaptic terminal release of more neurotransmitter in response to each action potential. And this form of plasticity seems to depend on the influx of presynaptic calcium during the conditioning tetanus. Synaptic strength is increased because of the residual calcium which is left in the terminal after a conditioning train of stimuli at the neuromuscular junction. And recent work also supports this hypothesis. Dependence of neurotransmitter release on the presynaptic calcium is highly nonlinear. That means the more calcium and more neurotransmitter release is not true. And several types of calcium sensitive proteins are present in the presynaptic terminals. where synaptotagmin, it triggers exocytosis, whereas other proteins like protein kinase C and calmodulin dependent protein kinases that regulate very short term increase in the neurotransmitter release. Several mechanisms cause short term decreases in the synaptic strength, like depletion of vesicles and also inactivation of presynaptic calcium channel. Now moving on to postsynaptic changes, which are long term changes and occurs at the postsynaptic terminal, and it includes LTP and LTD, that is long term potentiation and long term depression. So what is long term potentiation? It is a form of synaptic enhancement that lasts for days to even weeks. It occurs at the excitatory synapses of the mammalian cerebral cortex, and it is generated by train of high frequency stimulation applied on the presynaptic neurons. Let us come to the mechanism model of long term potentiation and long term depression. So to start with the tetanic stimuli, it causes release of glutamate in the presynaptic cleft by the presynaptic neuron. Now, what will be the effect on postsynaptic membrane? There will be opening of both AMPA and NMDA channels. First, AMPA will be opened. This is because it requires very low positive membrane potential to open, and then NMDA is gradually open, because opening of NMDA, it requires high positive membrane potential. NMDA is permeable to calcium, but AMPA is not. So as a result of opening of NMDA channels, there are high intracellular calcium in the postsynaptic cell. Now, in case of very high frequency stimulation, there is very high increase in the intracellular calcium, which activates calmodulin dependent protein kinases. And these kinases will phosphorylate the intracellular proteins. As a result of this, there will be recruitment of more AMPA or AMPA upregulation that causes long-term potentiation. And when the frequency of stimulation is low in comparison to what was happening in LTD, there will be moderate increase in intracellular calcium. As a result, there will be specific activation of phosphatases on the contrary to phosphokinases like calcineurin. So here, in case of LTD, phosphatases will be activated like calcineurin. As a result of this, there will be dephosphorylation of intracellular proteins, and there will be AMPA downregulation and removal of AMPA from the postsynaptic membrane. And this is the basis of long-term depression. Now, long-term potentiation in the hippocampus, which is the basis of memory, it can be demonstrated by the rat brain experiment, where in the hippocampus, CA3 neurons, which sends collaterals, which are also called Schaffer's collateral, to the CA1 neuron. So in case of control, one set of Schaffer collateral are stimulated, and the potential is recorded at the level of CA1 neurons. On the other hand, in case of test, the second set of Schaffer's collateral will be stimulated, and also the CA1 neurons will be partially depolarized. And at the same time, the EPSPs will be recorded at CA1. So pyramidal CA3 neurons in the hippocampus, they send axons to the CA1 pyramidal neurons. In control, electrode stimulates collateral that activates synapse on the postsynaptic CA1 neuron. CA1 neuron receives only presynaptic stimuli here. But in case of test, the electrode stimulates a different set of collateral that activates the same CA1 neuron. However, in this case, or in case of test, the presynaptic stimuli is paired with a postsynaptic partial depolarization that is delivered via a third microelectrode. So what is the result? We can see that in case of control, where the CA1 neuron is never depolarized, the EPSP amplitude is quite low. But on the other hand, where the presynaptic stimulation is paired with postsynaptic depolarization, the EPSP amplitude is quite high. So when CA1 neuron is pre-depolarized, the amplitude of EPSPs greatly increases. That means LTP has been induced. Induction of LTP requires coincident activity of the presynaptic terminals plus significant depolarization of the postsynaptic membrane. So this cooperative nature of two different inputs may become associated to form long-term potentiation. Just for example, the sight and sound of the pet dog that occurs simultaneously. On the contrary, sight of pet dog and the bell of a clock rarely occur simultaneously, and their neuronal equivalence will not be associated. Now let us come to the LTD or long-term depression, which is the basis of motor learning within the cerebellum. So the major cell within the cerebellum are called the Purkinje cells, which is depicted as P over here. It receives two input, one from the parallel fibers, which come from the granular cells, which again receives input from all the non-olive fibers via the non-olive structures via the MOSI fibers. Purkinje cells also receive another input called climbing fiber input from the olive. So the Purkinje cells receive powerful synaptic input from just a single climbing fiber which comes from a cell in the inferior olive nucleus, and each Purkinje cell also receives synaptic input from the parallel fibers which originate from granular cell of the cerebellum itself. This remarkable conjunction of synaptic input is the basis of theory of motor learning, where climbing fiber input reduces the errors and regulates MOSI fiber inputs by causing long-term depression on the Purkinje cells. EPSPs generated by the parallel fibers become smaller when both the parallel fibers and the cell's climbing fiber were co-activated at low frequencies. So stimulating either input alone did not cause any changes, but when they are co-activated, the changes occur. So cerebellar long-term depression can last for several hours.